Sorry for the delay, some technical problem. So we have the second lectures by Filippo Vernizzi, please.
Okay. So sorry, I forgot to mention something when I talked about the discovery of acceleration, which is, so it has been done in 98. There were two groups fighting for this measurement. One was the Supernovae Cosmology Project, and the other one was HiSEA Supernovae Search Team. And they both, well, the, in one case, Perlmutter, Sol Perlmutter for the Supernovae Cosmology Project, and in the other case, Adam Riess and Brian Schmidt for the HiSEA SST got the Nobel Prize in 2011. Okay, just to say. And if you want to, I mean, I particularly like it. If you want to read a book about the history of the discovery, there is a nice book called The 4% Universe. By Panek. Which I find it enjoyable. And another thing that, so there was a question about what is the strain of the gravitational wave? Just, well, it's not really important. So it describes the amplitude of the gravitational wave. And just assume that we have a Friedman, an Amperture Friedman universe flat, okay? So the metric is like that. I can introduce a perturbation of the metric, which is traceless and transverse. And I can write it, so basically I can have ij written, so I write down the metric, sorry. So there will be one component, which if the wave travel along the z direction, will be like that, okay? And so this is the plus polarization and the cross polarization will be like that, just to. Okay. Ah. And it measures what you see in the interferometer. Okay, very good. So now we discussed the gravitational waves as a way of inferring the luminosity distance. Clearly, for the moment, what's interesting is that for instance, with one event, we were able to measure H0, the value of the Hubble parameter. So for instance, just to show you, this was the measurement of the value of the Hubble parameter, oops, from GW170817, so with one single event, which is pretty remarkable. But probably the interest for the things that will come in the future, maybe with improved interferometers, so maybe going to space with LISA, and we were discussing with some of you. We were saying that LISA, for instance, will observe the merging of supermassive black holes. And so these are very much bigger objects with much bigger Chirp masses. And so we will be able to go at much higher redshifts. And so probe the expansion of history of the universe directly in a way that you cannot do with supernovae, just because we don't have supernovae up there and we cannot observe them up there at those redshifts. Okay, so now let's see let's relate the acceleration parameter to the content of the universe. For the moment, we have just talked about, the cinematics without saying anything about the dynamics. So what drives the accelerated expansion, okay? So what causes the acceleration? And We will assume GR here, and of course I won't do it for the lectures. So I will assume the standard Einstein's equations, Einstein tensor. So the geometry given in terms of the Einstein tensor is sourced by the stress energy momentum of matter, of what is contained by the universe. And I will assume that this stress energy tensor, T mu nu, is in a form compatible with the symmetries of the Friedmann-Lemaître Robertson-Walker metric. So I will write it like that. Okay. Where here G mu nu is the Friedmann-Lemaître Robertson-Walker metric, and rho is the energy density. P is the pressure. And U mu is a four vector, which is basically, it's the four velocity of this fluid, this homogeneous fluid that fills the universe, and is just given by minus one, zero, zero, zero. Okay. So I remind you the Friedmann equations that you have seen. And minus k over a squared. And then there is an equation describing the acceleration, which is minus 4 pi g over 3 rho plus 3 p. So the energy density plus 3 times the pressure. And obviously, you see that the universe accelerates if P is smaller than minus 1/3 the energy density. Okay. Okay, another thing that we have well, probably you have seen this with a seam, but suppose that the universe contains different fluids, and that each of them, if they are decoupled, each of them is respectively conserved, so it has it satisfies a continuity equation, and you have seen that we can rewrite this equation in this way. You can rewrite the time derivative in terms of a derivative with respect to the scale factor. So the derivative of rho I of each species with respect to the scale factor is given by minus 3 rho I over A, 1 plus W I, where W I is defined as the pressure of this species divided by the energy density of this species, and is called the equation of state parameter. And whenever I don't put an index here, so, well, if I, well, let me tell you later, maybe now. So let's make some examples. Sorry. Let's integrate first this equation, since we can do it. So this equation has a simple solution. Rho I is equal to rho I today. And then a factor which is due to the dilution of the species with the volume. Okay. So the notable examples are W equal to zero, which is non-relativistic matter, where the energy density scale is like 1 over a cube. Then you have radiation, okay, where the energy density scale is like 1 over a to the fourth. And then, as you can see, if W is equal to minus 1, the energy density is constant. So rho, and we call this a cosmological constant. So in this case, W equal to minus 1 corresponds to a constant energy density. And indeed, it's something that could work because the pressure of this species is equal to minus rho, so it satisfies this equation. Okay? It could lead to accelerated expansion. And also, as you know very well, species which have W, equation of state, negative, so tending to accelerate, dominate the universe in the future. Okay, so in a sense, whatever makes the universe accelerating will determine the fate of the universe in the future. Okay. Okay, we can write the accelerated expansion. We can write the second derivative of the scale factor in this way, assuming that we have two species. While we are looking at the universe at late time, so we can neglect radiation. Okay. And we know that there are baryons and cold dark matter. So let's denote both baryons and cold dark matter by omega m with the equation of state equal to parameter equal to zero. And then we have some dark energy component. And we can just write this in this way. Okay. Well, then Q that was defined as A dot dot over A H can be written as 1/2 omega meter plus 1 plus 3 W dark energy omega dark energy. So how do I see that? Well, I use the fact that omega I is defined by pi g 3 over a squared rho I. So I take there is a square here. Otherwise it wasn't working. So I take this, I divide by the Hubble by H squared, and I use this this definition here, okay? So, and for if dark energy is a cosmological constant, I find that Q is equal to 1/2 omega meter minus omega lambda. right? Because here I would have minus 3 plus 1 minus 2, and then the 1 half remove the 2. And I could also write that Q0 is this. Okay. Now, just to have an idea, we know that today omega matter is about 0.3, 0.25, but let's plug some numbers just to see. So this should be 0.15 minus 0.7 equal to minus 0.55, okay? So this is the acceleration parameter that we measure today. Another thing that we can learn easily is that we can estimate the redshift at which the energy density of the dark energy component has become as important as the one of dark matter. So this, for instance, we can say, we want to write when the energy density of lambda is about the one of dark matter, and we know that the energy density, so the omega matter scales like omega matter 0 to the 1 plus z cube. So we obtain that this, if you plug here the numbers, you obtain that the redshift at which the dark energy and the matter component are comparable is about 1.3. Okay, so this takes place rather recently. But there is an even more interesting, slightly more interesting redshift, which is the one at which the universe has begun to accelerate, okay, which is slightly different. So if I take this equation and I assume that dark energy is lambda, just to be specific, but then you can play with that and change. Then I have that this is omega minus 2 rho lambda. And this will be proportional to omega matter 0, 1 plus z cube minus 2 omega lambda 0. Okay. Yeah. Sorry? But sometimes you use a different notation on the parentheses. No, I'm joking. This is the typical joke with Paolo. So let's see when this happens. So when is the universe going from an accelerating to an accelerating phase? So before being accelerating, the universe was decelerating. And if you plug the numbers, you find that z, at which the universe made a transition, so is given by this, omega matter 0 to the 1 third minus 1, and this is about 0.7. So this was very recently. So maybe since we have seen that we can go with supernovae pretty high in redshift, maybe we can hope to observe the transition between the accelerated expansion, which takes place here, and the deceleration, which is about here. Okay, this is a plot where the redshift is in log, but here you can see it better. Well, for instance, this dashed line corresponds roughly to our universe, and you can see that at some point the universe starts decelerating. This is compared to an empty universe. So, what's important to see here is you see when in 98 when people observed for the first time the acceleration, it was not that everybody bought it immediately. So there was a debate. For instance, one possibility that people raised up was the fact that supernovae could look dimmer, not because because of the expansion, but because there was some dust, okay, intervening between us and them. And of course, if you assume that there is some dust, you would see the same effect due to dust forever when you go at higher redshift. And this, for instance, was a model with a high Z-gray dust. I don't know exactly what model it was. But this dust model would produce a curve which is in a high discrepancy with what you observe today. And this is due to the fact that at some point the acceleration, when you go in the past, stops and you start going to a decelerating phase. Okay, so this was a rather important observation in order to establish the fact that the supernova people were really seeing an effect due to the expansion and not just to the fact that there was some absorption of light. Of the supernova. I think so. This plot shows roughly the same, but as measured by Lasker Sachs surveys. So basically, you can infer the evolution of the Hubble parameter also as a function of redshift, also by looking at galaxy surveys, by looking, for instance, at quasars. This is BOSS. These are galaxies, redshift space. These are quasars, and these are Lyman alphas. Okay, and you can go back in redshift and see that the Hubble parameter at some point. You see that at some point you start decelerating, and this happens more or less around z equal to 0.7. Okay, these are already shown. Okay, maybe I come out from here. Okay. Yes.
I would like to ask if this transition between decelerating and acceleration can be understood as the transition between cosmological constant domination and matter domination periods, or is it more subtle?
No, it's not more subtle. So the question was, do we understand that the transition between the deceleration and the accelerated phase is due to the fact that before the universe was dominated by matter, no relativistic matter, and then later it's dominated by the cosmological constant or by some dark energy? No, it's exactly that, yes, of course. And we have seen it here. We could infer, if you assume a cosmological constant, we can infer the redshift at which this happens, and this roughly corresponds to the redshift that we observe. So everything is consistent. Okay. Yeah, you can see that when the energy density of dark energy is negligible, this is negative. Okay, this can only be negative. Okay, other questions about that? Yeah. Yeah. Of course.
Yeah. So what would be
Who doesn't believe in inflation? No. No, no, I'm joking. Well, this is a question, a very big question. What we understand is that when we go back in time, in the standard cosmological picture, we arrive at a moment, which I call the Big Bang, where the universe was expanding at a rate which is much higher than the one today. The temperature was much higher, etc. And if you go back, even backward, we think that there must have been another period of accelerated expansion, which we called inflation, because we know that the initial condition of the universe without this period of inflation appear extremely fine-tuned. Okay, so we need this period of inflation to prepare the standard Big Bang cosmology. And so this is currently the way we understand this as initial. In fact, you said it well. These are the initial conditions, okay? And then what the matter, so if you exclude dark energy, what matter does is to slow down these initial conditions. So it's like throwing a stone up, and so the stone will have initially a high velocity, and then we slow down because of the attraction of the Earth. What it happens is that at some point a new component accelerated in the universe appears. Yeah. Sure. In fact, we are going to discuss this probably next time, but we will see that the fact that the cosmological constant is not too large allowed the existence of a universe sufficiently long to give birth to us, to life, etc. Yeah, of course. But concerning the initial condition, I mean, I cannot really answer. I know that now we think that the most plausible model to explain the initial phase of the universe is inflation, but maybe this is not the case. Okay. Well, at the beginning, we discussed about the standard candles, and we mentioned another way of measuring distance through standard rulers. So let me just mention what are standard rulers. And in general, standard rulers are useful to measure the angular diameter distance. And probably you will do this with the CMB, but let's mention this rapidly. So how the standard rulers work is that if you know the size, the physical size of an object, and you put it far away, then by measuring the angle subtended by this object, you can infer the distance simply by using this relation, right? The distance is equal to the size, the physical size of the object divided by the angle of this object, okay? So now we are going to measure, so imagine that you have the observer here that sees a physical object here. Well, here, yeah, this is an object with the size R here. Okay, this is the angle. So in cosmology, there is the usual story of the scale factor intervening. So in fact, in this picture, so the radius will be always the comoving radius. In this picture, this will be a comoving size, and we are going to define the angular diameter distance in this way, okay, as the physical size of the object divided by theta, but there are also definitions in the literature as the comoving size of the object divided by the angle. And remember the line element of the metric was, so there was this term here. So we are interested in the dependence of the line element in terms of the angle theta. So the size, the physical size of the object will be given by A at the time of the object, F k of chi theta. Now I can write this as a 0 over 1 plus z. And so I find that, I find that this is given by a 0, 1 plus z, f k of chi. In other words, the angular diameter distance is equal to the luminosity distance divided by 1 plus z squared. Okay. So, examples of standard rulers. Well, the CMB position, peak position, the peak's position. Is an example of standard rulers. You see this in well, today or tomorrow, but you know that, yes? Questions? Because we want the physical size of the object, so imagine that you have an object with comoving size. So this does not depend in time. So you take it. The physical size will be. Will be the scale factor at the time where I want this object to be times the comoving size. So imagine that I have an object like that. In the past, it will be shrink, no, by the expansion. So I have to consider this shrinking and the physical size of the object back then. Okay. Okay, so at the time of before recombination, there was a photon baryon plasma that was undertaking oscillations again by the fact that the pressure was opposing gravitational force. At some point, the oscillations stop because of the coupling. And so you have a picture of this oscillation at the time of the coupling, and the position of the peaks are determined by the sound horizon, okay, which is basically the distance traveled by photons since the beginning of time. So let me denote it by RS. These are defined as the speed of propagation of the oscillations in the plasma times the scale factor times dt, okay? And I can again change variable and use the redshift. Well, I write the result. And now I'm integrating between redshift decoupling and infinity, because I want to integrate between the time zero, so between the Big Bang and a certain time at the decoupling. And so I will have CS dz over h of z. Okay. So roughly, this the horizon size at the decoupling is given by h at the decoupling minus 1 times the speed of the fluctuations, sorry, which is about knowing that the photon baryon plasma is a relativistic, the fluctuation travel at a like in radiation, okay? This CS squared is roughly 1/3, which gives you 1/3 square root of 3. Okay, this is affected by the amount of baryons that you have respect to dark matter, etc. But this is the rough picture. And so the angular diameter distance would be given by RS times the angular scale at which you observe these oscillations in the sky. And this theta is can be given in terms of dl at which you have a peak. Okay, if you have the CL as a function of L, well, L is the multiples of the CMB. So typically, the interpeak distance is about delta L of about 220. Okay, so you can determine theta, which is about 1 degree, and if you know, if you can model RS, you can infer the angular diameter distance. Okay. Now the angular diameter distance for the CMB is very sensitive to what? To which parameter? Do you know? No. Curvature, yeah, exactly. And you, well, we could do the calculation, but maybe a better way of thinking about this is imagine that you are measuring, so you have the last scattering surface. Here, you're measuring this spot in the sky, determined by the oscillations of the baryon photon plasma. And if the spatial sections are Euclidean, so if the universe is flat, then so this triangle, you know that this triangle has the sum of the angles of these triangles is 180 degrees, right? But if it's not, then and imagine that that it is the universe is closed, then I would see something like that. So I would see that the angle is a bit puffier, is a bit larger. Okay. Maybe it's better to use a larger ladder. Otherwise, you don't see the effect. But you will see something like that. Okay, so you would see that for the same scale, I have a larger angle subtended. On the contrary, so this would be a closed universe. On the contrary, in an open universe, for the same angle, I would see, for the same scale, I would see a smaller angle. So this is very well measured. this is modeled, okay, but I know it. I have a pretty good idea of it. So I can measure the angular diameter distance, and from it I can infer the curvature by knowing that there is this this effect. Okay. And in fact, one exercise that I let you do is to show that chi, so the comoving radius at the redshift of the coupling. Well, actually, well, yes, for large redshift, let's say, neglecting the cosmological constant, neglecting dark energy, can be written as twice arc hyperbolic sinus of the square root of omega k divided by omega meter today. So that you see that this enters in the angular diameter distance in here, and you see that this is very sensitive to the curvature of the universe. Another distance ladder is the same effect, but in the galaxy distribution, and this is known as the baryon acoustic oscillations, which will be more sensitive to omega matter, so to the presence of dark matter and baryons. And this allows to infer, to set the constraints on parameters, for instance, on the amount of matter that there is in the universe with respect to the amount of dark energy, assuming a cosmological constant here. Okay. So this straight line goes from one to one, so it will be it will lie so we lie here if you are in a flat universe, because we are considering 1 equal omega lambda. So these are omega lambda today plus omega meter plus omega k 0. Okay. So if the sum of these two is 1, like here, omega k is equal to 0. And as we said, the CMB measure this. Okay. So what does a supernova measure? But I can show you the plot. Supernova measure something like that. So we said CMB tell us that omega k is roughly zero. Supernova type 1a . So look at the plot. Does it really measure this? This was the acceleration parameter. Well, maybe staring at this plot is not so easy, but if he was really measuring this, I would expect this ellipse to be bent like that, right? So for instance, let's make a test. Let's consider if omega matter is 0.4, well, you invert this relation and you should find that omega 0 is equal, so there is a proportionality constant. So you see that a constant Q0, so with a constant Q0 would be something more like that, okay? In fact, what really supernova measure is more a combination of two omega matter minus omega lambda 0. And this is this was surprising to me, but in fact it happens for a strange cancellation. So basically, what people do is not just look at the expansion of the luminosity distance up to second order in Z, but they do a full calculation, and there is a funny partial cancellations between the order Z square terms with the order z cube terms, okay, such that at the end you don't measure this combination here, which would give an ellipsoid like that, but you measure this combination here, okay. So this is something so if you want to reproduce this plot and you just use the acceleration parameter, you spend some time understanding why it doesn't work, and after a while, I discovered why. And then the BAOs are sensitive to omega matter, so something like that. Here we are about 0.7, and here we are about 0.3. Okay. And if you want, this has been called the concordance model, and it's the base of a lambda CDM model. Okay. There are other observations that point to this cosmological, to these values of cosmological parameters. So, for instance, It was observed for a long time that the age of globular clusters was about 13 giga-years. And without cosmological constant, you cannot explain, the age of the universe would be less than the age of the globular clusters. So this was a conundrum for a long time. And cosmological constant just makes the universe older. And therefore allows you to explain this fact. There is also, you can count the number of clusters in the universe. The number of clusters depends on the mass function, but also on a factor on a geometrical factor that depends on the universe, on the expansion of the universe, and this also points towards an omega matter of 0.3. So several observations points to this concordance model, if you want. Questions before moving to a different topic? Okay. Actually, I have forgot to mention. So I showed you this. This is a different plot. Instead of showing the plane omega lambda omega meter, here this plot shows the plane W, the equation of state of the dark energy omega meter. And you see that the observations, well, in the case there is the CMB and supernovas with this Pantheon collection and MBOs, okay? So baryon acoustic oscillations. And it seems that cosmological parameters are compatible with the cosmological constant. So for with the W equal to minus one, okay? Eventually, you can also study the evolution of the equation of state, try to infer whether this equation of state, so whether we have a cosmological constant only today or if this changed in the past. And sometimes people parameterize this as saying that, so W is given by W0, which is the value today, and WA, which is the value of the cosmological, of the equation of state of dark energy in the past. So this is a simple two parameters modeling that shows you when the scale factor is equal to A0, so this is zero, and I obtain the value of W today. And when I go back in the past, where A becomes large, I obtain a different value. I think it's something like that. So that I should obtain WA instead, okay? And this is what you see. So again, it would seem that, W0, so there is no evolution of W. And WA is zero, and W0 is around minus one. Okay, so all data are consistent with the cosmological constant. So now we are going to see why this is puzzling. When is the end? 12:30. Ah, okay. Okay. So now we will start studying the cosmological constant a bit more. Okay. So as you know, the Einstein's equations have a term that has been introduced by Einstein in 1917 to find the static universe, because when you try to solve the Einstein's equation in a cosmological setting, he was finding always an expanding or collapsing universe. So he decided to add this cosmological constant to reproduce a static universe, which is what was believed to be the case at that time. Okay. Later on, when Hubble measured the expansion in 1929, Einstein called the introduction of the cosmological constant his greatest mistake, as you well know. But after 1998, probably the greatest mistake was to believe that it was the greatest mistake, because it seems that the cosmological constant is back again. Okay. So earlier we also wrote the Einstein's equation in this way. T mu nu plus something mu nu representing the cosmological constant, but this is exactly the same. Okay. Just to connect with what we did until now. So the Einstein's equation comes from an action. Was the first term is we can say is lambda. The second term is the Einstein-Hilbert term, is the Ricci scalar. And then, in principle, I could have higher order terms suppressed by some scale, because we know that GR is a non-renormalizable theory. And so there are higher order terms that are generated by quantum corrections. But at lowest order in derivatives, so at lowest energies, I have lambda, which does not contain any derivative. So I expect it to be there at low energy. And then I will start having the lowest derivative of the metric, which are represented by the Ricci. And the fact that this action is written in terms of the Ricci and the higher Curvatus case is due to the fact that I want to respect the general principle of general relativity, which is diffeomorphism invariance. Okay, so the fact that my equations or my description must be invariant under coordinate reparametrizations. Okay. Now we are going to study. How quantum corrections or vacuum fluctuations of matter affect the cosmological constant. Okay. So we know that vacuum fluctuations of all particles change the value, contribute to the cosmological constant. And to be specific, let's assume, so let me call this loop corrections to the CC. Let's assume that the matter is a scalar field, but I could make the calculation with other particles. So let us take a scalar field with kinetic energy. Yeah, so this is when I write this, I mean g mu nu d mu phi d nu phi. Okay, this is a shorthand notation. This is the kinetic energy of the scalar field, and this is the potential energy of the scalar field. For instance, I could take the potential energy to be a mass of the scalar field, pi square plus lambda plus a quartic term. For the moment, let me be specific. Okay. Yeah. Now I want to compute how quantum corrections of the scalar field affect the cosmological constant or contribute to the cosmological constant. Okay. Okay.
On top on a certain background bar.
So let me put it. I'm writing here lambda. Okay, in this potential. This is the bare value of the cosmological constant, and I want to compute the renormalized value of the cosmological constant once I include the quantum corrections due to phi. Okay. So in a sense, I want to compute the vacuum expectation value of this potential, because at the end it will be the cosmological constant in this potential. Okay. Taking into account the quantum corrections. Okay. This is also called the effective potential. So I want to find at the end the value of the cosmological constant renormalized by quantum corrections. Eventually, well, I'm not so interested in that, but also the mass, the renormalized value of the mass of the potential, of the quartic coupling, and other things, if there are other things. Okay. So I want the potential of the scalar field once I include the quantum corrections. Okay, so quantum corrections are taken into account by what is called the quantum effective action, which is gamma phi. Okay. And the characteristic of the effective action is that, let's say, the VEV, the vacuum expectation value of the scalar field, including quantum correction, is solution of the equation that you obtain by minimizing it. Okay. So, by the way, you can find, well, I will follow calculation in Weinberg, where you can find also explanations on the effective action in his second book on QFT, chapter 16. So what I want to compute, so my effective action at the end will contain a term which is of this form. And then there will be other terms. But I would like to find to focus on this one. Of the full Hamiltonian, you said?
Of the Hamiltonian, you just said you think that the potential.
Of the potential. I want to compute the effective potential, yes, for this scalar field.
No, I mean, if you want to calculate energy expectation value, don't you take the expectation value of the full Hamiltonian?
I see. I don't know if I understand your question. So at the end, my effective action, the effective action will be the integral, the volume integral of a Lagrangian, which will be an effective Lagrangian, which would also contain a kinetic term, etc. But I'm not interested. In fact, I will be interested in considering a scalar field which is a constant, okay, to simplify. Okay. Of course, I could also consider excitation, etc. But I would just like to focus on the simplest case, which is to compute the effective potential and neglect derivatives of the scalar field. Consider a constant scalar field which will allow me to make the calculation.
Sorry, what is the nature of our quantum fluctuations, or do we just simply consider these vacuum loops and then solve?
What is the first part of the question?
What's the nature of the quantum fluctuations?
The nature? Well, all fields have a quantum fluctuations, like you can observe in the Lamb shift, for instance, or and this is what I would like to compute. These are vacuum fluctuations of the fields.
So is this related to the matter content of the universe?
To the
matter content of the universe?
Well, all particles will have their quantum fluctuations which contribute to the cosmological constant. So the question was, is this related to the matter quantity of the universe? So yes, but it's also related to particles that we don't see in practice, okay? So all standard model particles will have quantum fluctuations. All standard model particles will contribute to the renormalized value of the cosmological constant, not only scalar phi, I don't know, this could be the X, for instance, not only scalars, but also particles that have not been seen yet will contribute to the cosmological constant. And this will be also, in principle, relevant for that. But I think it's a good moment to. I have 1 minute. So I will tell you. So we will use, so we can compute the effective action by using a functional integration of the original of E to the I, the original action shifted by phi zero, okay. This functional integration is restricted to only to one PI, which are one particle irreducible diagrams. And just for those who don't remember what they are, these are diagrams that if you cut one of the internal lines, diagrams that you cannot cut into separate diagrams by cutting one of the internal lines, okay? I think I could... Yes. And the effective action corresponds to the sum of loop diagrams. So, for instance, one loop with external line of this background field phi zero, okay? So yeah, all one and higher loops, okay? And what I will do next time is to do the calculation at one loop. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, so in the potential, I can't see any couplings with the standard model particles. Do we assume that it interacts with if anything else, or there are only the self-interactions?
Now I'm going to assume just self-interactions. Yeah, I'm going to take the simplest case. Already it's a scalar field, and I'm just taking the self-interaction. But so yeah, this will not be so interesting. The interesting thing will be to see how how the value of the cosmological constant will depend on the UV of the theory, so on the cutoff of the theory.
Okay, so it's time to go to the line. thanks, Filippo.
Thanks.